Trinity. I have a couple of announcements, so would you please be seated? Firstly, I publish the banns of marriage between Callum William Cotton, single of the parish of St. John's, Wroxall, and Holly Amber Bailey, also single of the parish of St. John's, Wroxall, with a qualifying connection to this parish. This is for the third and final time of asking. So if any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. Wonderful. So we pray for the couple of Callum and Holly as they prepare for their wedding, which is on the 5th of August, so only a couple more weeks for them. And I have now an announcement. I have been with these churches as curate now for 2 years, learning about parish life and making a valued contribution, I hope, to these parishes. Part of a curacy is discerning what kind of priest you are and where your future lies. I am clear that I stand within the Anglo-Catholic tradition in the Church of England, and that I want to stay with my family on the island, where it is proving very hard to attract clergy to. I worshipped at St. Saviour's Chaplain, an Anglo-Catholic church, before I went to theological college, and with the bishop's encouragement, I feel drawn to return there and to Good Shepherd Lake, Godshill, and Ventnor, St. Alban. However, these churches will present significant challenges, and it is also a challenge anyway to return to one's sending parish. The bishop and archdeacon have therefore suggested that between October and December, I spend 3 out of 4 Sundays a month in those churches, as well as time in the week, finding out about their current state and if it is truly to be God's will for me to move there. If at the end of this period I feel it right, and also the 4 churches, I will go through a formal interview process in the new year. If not, I will return to my curacy here and seek alternative openings elsewhere on the island. During this period, I will remain the curate of these parishes. Hugh and I will work on a detailed plan for this time, which will be put to the archdeacon and both sets of parishes. This plan has only become fully formed within the last week, and I realise it may come as a shock so soon after Hugh's retirement. I hope you will join me in praying for the discernment of God's will for mine and Jules's future. That's the official wording. I would like to say, please don't feel that I am abandoning anybody, because I will be between the 7 churches. So I am going to be around, I'm still going to be here. Okay. One Sunday a month that I'm back in each parishes, I will be at this church and then go on to either St. E's or St. C's, like we do on a normal rota. So it's only actually when you work it out, 1 Sunday less, I will be here, as I always try and grab you on the rota. Don't know why. So please don't think that I am abandoning the ship, okay? I am not. It just sounds worse than it actually is, because it's an official statement. Thank you. Do please stand. so we begin with our opening hymn, number 353. Dear Lord and Father of mankind. Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all this past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The epistle is taken from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, beginning at verse 12. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
heaven may be compared to someone who sowed the seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, an enemy has done this. The slaves said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, no, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burnt, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and the disciples approached him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
But he switches his metaphors a bit from the parable we heard last week about the sower and the type of soil. This week, something bad happens to a good farmer. A few years ago, I met a young mother who had lost her job. She'd missed too much work when her children were too sick and she couldn't take them to school. Without an income, she couldn't pay her bills and was worried that her utilities would be cut off or that she would be evicted from her home. On top of that, her car had broken down and she had no money for repairs. Without a car, she couldn't look for a new job. One thing had piled on top of another until she was overwhelmed with hardship. She felt like the world was out to get her. How can God let this happen to me, she asked. What have I done to deserve this? Such a moment isn't always the perfect time to point out that actually none of us are good. All of us deserve far worse than we get out of life. We are all broken sinners. And it isn't usually a good time to go into a long explanation of theological theories. But nevertheless, it is a good question. Why does God allow evil in the world? People like this young mother didn't come to me looking for a judgmental sermon She came looking for a glimmer of hope. The people who gathered on that beach to hear Jesus tell their stories weren't much different. They had experienced oppression from Rome. Even among their own people, they had watched the rich get richer while the poor got poorer. Life wasn't fair. How could God allow his people to continue to suffer while evil seemed to flourish around them? When would the awaited Messiah deliver them from this miserable existence and bring judgment to Israel's oppressors? Yet here was Jesus, looking and sounding very much like he might just be the one for whom they'd been waiting. And he was telling them stories about farming. Who cares about weed control when your world is falling down around your ears? Let anyone with ears listen, Jesus said. And we are reminded that these parables are far more than just entertaining stories. They are stories that read us. How we hear them depends on the condition of our hearts and minds. Whether we may be in our journey of faith, these stories may speak directly to us in our current circumstance. There are many ways to interpret the parable of the weeds. At its most basic level, this story might be about how difficult it is to tell weeds from wheat. Bearded darnel is an annoying weed that looks very much like wheat, especially before maturity, and it can carry a poisonous fungus. If it is harvested and ground together with the wheat, the resulting flour is spoiled and useless. As the grain matures, it's easy to tell the slender heads of the bearded darnel from the fuller heads of wheat. But by then, it's too late to uproot one without damaging the other. If we are part of the crowd, we simply hear that pulling weeds can cause more harm than good, destroying the very crops we want to harvest. But this story is probably more than just a farming tip for weed control. The disciples ask for an explanation once they are alone with Jesus, and he spells out the metaphors that matter, identifying the main characters in this story. We might get sidetracked by the things Jesus doesn't say. He doesn't identify the servants of the landowner, for example. They must have been taking care of the field, or they wouldn't have noticed the weeds popping up. But the enemy who sowed the weeds just leaves. And Jesus doesn't explain this either. But we probably shouldn't concern ourselves too much with what Jesus doesn't say, but I think it might be good to remember that the field is God's, and God will continue to nurture and care for his kingdom, while the devil does nothing to support or care for the seed he has sown. There are also varying interpretations of the field itself. While Jesus says it is the world, some consider the later explanation, where the angels collect the causes of evil and all evildoers out of the kingdom, as an indication that this is really about evil growing alongside faithful members of the church. But Jesus does not equate the church with God's kingdom. Nor should we get so self-centered that we consider this story to be about the evil that lurks in each of us as individuals. Paul covers that in Romans 7, as we heard a couple of weeks ago. I do the evil things I do not want to do, and I do not do the good things that I want to do. I am wretched. This brings us back to those troubling weeds. Why shouldn't we pull them if we see evil choking out the good around it? Why does Jesus say, leave them be until the harvest? Depending on how this parable reads us, we might find some pretty good reasons to leave the weeds alone. Sometimes weeds are too big to be pulled. Their roots have entwined with the roots of good plants, and pulling up the one will also uproot the other. Sometimes what you thought was a weed is actually a good plant, and what you thought was a good plant could actually be a cunning weed. They aren't always easy to distinguish from one another. We're not good at judging between wheat and weeds. That's God's job anyway. And that brings us back to that first question. Why doesn't God do something about the evil we see everywhere? Where is judgment when you need it? This is one of only three parables for which Jesus gives a detailed explanation in Matthew's Gospel. We heard the first one last week about good seed spread lavishly on the four types of soil. Next week we will hear the parable of the mustard seed, along with some shorter parables about the kingdom of God. This parable of the weeds has something in common with each of the other two. We hear the connection with the first story in the seeds that are sown. And like the one we will hear next week, this parable also teaches us about judgment. Judgment will come, and evil will be destroyed, but not yet. This is the already not yet reality of Christ's kingdom. The kingdom has already broken into our world in the person of Jesus Christ, and is already at work among us through the Holy Spirit. But the kingdom has not yet reached its completion. The kingdom is becoming, like seed planted in a field. We might wonder, how can this be the kingdom of God if evil is still present? And what might raise even more questions? Why do we still see racial equality? Why is there still poverty? Why does disease claim so many lives? Where is God in all our suffering? Why do people reject Jesus? Why isn't judgment happening now? As Christians, we should not be surprised that evil is still active, even while God's reign is already present. The kingdom comes with limitless grace in the midst of an evil world. And the issue is one of identity. If we take our identity from the kingdom of limitless grace, how will that identity be lived out? How does this parable affect you? Are you centered in Christ so that nothing can uproot you? Is your identity grounded in God's limitless grace? And are you willing to extend that grace to others? Can anyone tell whether you are a wheat or a weed by the way you live your life? Do you let God be the judge of who belongs in God's kingdom? Like those workers in the field, we may think it's our job to pull the weeds, to judge who is worthy to flourish in God's kingdom and who should be rooted out. But that is not our job. Judgment is God's job. God will take care of removing evil in God's own good time. And these days it feels more and more like God's own good time is getting nearer and nearer. The evil that has just about run its course in this weary world, and judgment day must surely be coming soon. If so, shouldn't we have a greater sense of urgency to be ready for that day? Do you want to be the good grain shining in the sun? Or do you want to be something that sort of resembles good grain, but is actually toxic? You see, Jesus hasn't switched metaphors randomly. Last week he described the abundant generosity of a God who sows seeds lavishly everywhere, even on soil where it might not flourish. In today's parable, the soil is the world, and the children of God are the good seed being scattered to increase the kingdom while there is still time. So how does this parable affect us? Are we weeds taking up precious space and robbing nutrients from the soil? Or are we the good grain, multiplying God's abundant mercy in the world? Again, it's a question of generosity, giving abundantly to heal the world and increase God's reign, or insisting on our own importance, getting our own way, taking whatever, and we get by with whatever means. The good grain gives, the weeds take. Which are you? But here's the good news about parables. You can only push a metaphor so far before it stops making sense. We can't change ourselves from weeds to wheat any more than we can change ourselves from rocky, thorny ground into good soil. But Jesus can. So take a moment to examine your own heart right now. Who have you already decided is a weed to be excluded from fellowship in Christ's church? Who have you nurtured so that their roots are faith and strong? Who has nurtured your own faith and helped you to grow in Christ? Can your life this week show others that God's kingdom is alive and growing within you? Amen. And so let us stand and confirm our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was in Abraham. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We hope for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us now pray to the Father in heaven.
Let us draw near to a just and merciful God and thank him for all his goodness. And let us point out our concerns for the church and the world. We pray for the church throughout the world, in our country, in our diocese, on our island, in our parish, and for all who serve this parish. And we pray for Hugh and for Tony and for their future plans to be in God's hands. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you keep us from all that would damage our witness, from false doctrine, from exclusive opinions, from pride in our own ideas, from indifference to lives that seem to lie outside our care. We pray for all who are persecuted for their belief, for all who are struggling in their faith, and especially today we pray for all those parishes on this island without a priest. Give our congregations courage and insight to act in the right way, in compassion and love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for a world set about with difficulties and aggression, with climate problems and with hunger. We ask your guidance for leaders of countries where power is misused and rights are disregarded. We continue to pray for Ukraine, for Syria, for Afghanistan, for those suffering in the heat or the floods, for refugees and for all who try and help them. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our community here in Ventnor, for all those visiting in Fringe Week, for a sense of companionship and enjoyment. And we ask your blessing on those families who are struggling the summer holidays and on those who help them. Lord, in your mercy. Dear Lord, look with mercy on all those who are finding life difficult through illness, unhappiness, or the difficulties of old age. And in our three parishes, we pray for Ida Gordon, Duncan Radcliffe, Jennifer Peralta, Pauline Smith, Lisa Ellis, Miranda Trembler, Sue Watts, Shirley Tamkin, Colleen Dodson, and Wesley Watson. And also we think especially today of Mary, of Rodney Palmer, and of Michael Wood. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who have died and those who will miss them. Paul Johnson, Robin Lilly, Bill Clemens, and Eric Walsh. And we pray for our own loved ones departed and thank you for their lives. Lord, in your mercy. Lord our God, in all the events and phases of our life, we give thanks for your steadfast and unchanging love, which sustains and directs us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Do you please stand for me, please? To crown all things, there must be love to bind all together and complete the whole. Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Thank you. now sing our offertory hymn, number 103.
Hallelujah, hearts to heaven and voices great. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, ever praising you and singing. by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Catherine, St. Boniface, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
We continue on page 12. So let's pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son is the true vine and the source of life, ever giving himself that the world may live, may we so receive within ourselves the power of his death and passion, that in his saving cup we may share his glory and be made perfect in his love, for he is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. I'm afraid I have to just say farewell, because I now have to rush off down to the old church to do a wedding blessing. So I do apologise, I can't stay for coffee, which I so didn't do it right now. So bless you all and see you next week. Thank you. I knew that. I have a little blessing. I was checking that my right-hand woman knew what I was doing. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you all, always. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. It's a shame that Tony's underway as I was going to say a few things. I'm sure we're all very sad to see that DVD was on 3 month attachment, but since they used, at least we've got it for another 2 months, and we'll see him once a month thereafter. He's been an asset to the whole benefice, the greatly missed. But we wish him all the very best. Just looking at some of the notes, a very young church I know is leading the service, the first one of the summer at Bonchurch Old Church, which we understand starts at 8 o'clock tonight. So, any of you who'd like to join the old church, we'd be very pleased to see you there. Now, April might seem a long way off, but Alan and Kay are going to organise another jigsaw sale, and apparently we start now by getting jigsaws made. And if you have a look at the Sunday notes, you can see that Alan and Kay have left their telephone number, so if anybody can do anything to help, please do bring them. Next week's workshop is at 9:30 for service holiday communion. Let's all have a nice cup of tea.
Our final hymn, hymn 440, Leaving Out, verses 4 and 5.
Thank you.
love and serve the Lord.
Amen.